The second person I want to very briefly talk about is Marek Edelman, a staunchly anti-Zionist Jew who was a deputy commander of the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising, right? Okay, who passed away at his home in Warsaw on October 2nd, the birthday of Gandhi, incidentally. Little footnote there. Now, you notice that I said he passed away at his home in Warsaw. You wouldn't expect a person who had been the deputy commandant of the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising not to have gone to Israel at the conclusion of the war, because the Jews who survived the Holocaust almost invariably went to Israel after the creation of Israel. Marek Edelman didn't. And I think it's instructive to understand why he didn't. And you can understand that from his later life, because from his later life, he becomes one of the most ferocious critics of the policy of the state of Israel towards the Palestinians. And in fact, he's one of the first to point out in Israel that the treatment being handed out to the Palestinians by the state of Israel was too eerily reminiscent for him of the conduct of the Nazis towards the Jews in Germany. And he should have known. And in Poland, he should have known. He was a survivor of the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising, a commandant of it. And what he says about the uprising is also important, because again, I think it helps us reflect on the nature of violence and nonviolence, which I'm sad to say is almost never a part of the discussion anywhere when we speak about resistance. The centrality of nonviolence. Edelman resisted to the very end also the idea that this Warsaw Ghetto Uprising was a heroic affair, which is of course how everybody in Israel was going to play it up. I mean, one of the reasons they had to play it up this way is that, you know, that the crucial fact about the history of the oppression of the Jews in the Holocaust and in the years preceding that is a fact that there was virtually no resistance. I mean, this is a point that really is very grudgingly accepted. It's very often disputed, but this remains almost the indisputable fact. And one of the reasons that happened was, and Edelman points out, that in the ghetto itself, for a year, killings had been going on. People would disappear. And he says, we simply could not believe. The ghetto could not believe it. People didn't want to believe that an atrocity of this scale was being perpetrated, right? But he resists to the end this idea that this resistance was a heroic resistance. And this is what he says very simply and so elegantly. He says, quote, this is a book of conversations between him and an interlocutor that was published very recently. And he says, quote, we fought simply not to allow the Germans alone to pick the time and place of our deaths. How elegant, if you think of it, right? But how much dignity there is in an observation of this kind. So even as he's involved in that, I think, in fact, it was an act of nonviolent resistance in many ways. Because of the inherent dignity of that act, the thought that went behind it. And he also resisted, by the way, attempts made in Israel, still being made, to elevate the number of resistors. There were only 220 people involved in the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. There were claims being made that there were 10,000 being involved in the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. And he resisted. He says, well, I was there. I was a deputy commandant of it. There were 220 resistors and that's it. We cannot simply multiply these numbers in the hope that we can try to let the future generation know that, yeah, there were thousands of us who just fought the Nazis, you know. But he's of course equally critical, by the way, of the Palestinians as well later on. I mean, in 2002, he writes a letter which was barely circulated. It's a letter addressed to the commanders of all Palestinian military, paramilitary, and guerrilla groups where he says that you also have engaged in acts of indiscriminate violence. And this too reminds me of what the state of Israel has been doing and of what the Nazis were doing against Jews. Right? So I think he's quite ecumenical, if I may put it this way, but these are lives of interculturality. Right? These are people who live between cultures, amidst cultures, and stake certain kind of ethical positions. So I've suggested so far two, I'm going to conclude very quickly now, I've suggested two ways that of that we need to think about resistance. One is a radical commitment to the idea of nonviolence, and secondly, an attentiveness to the categories, right? Because I've suggested that it's not simply a matter of cultural imperialism now, right? Cultural imperialism is too facile a phrase. It doesn't really tell us much now. I think we're now speaking about an imperialism of categories, right? Thirdly, something that we have discussed in previous meetings, I don't think I'm going to elaborate it on any great detail, but perhaps an Occidentalism or a reverse anthropology is very much in order. Very much in order. Now, that means that perhaps we can also take some of the kinds of risks and hazards that are involved in it. There's no reason why we shouldn't. And I would go so far as to suggest that rather than being polite about it, let's not simply assume that we want to write the history of the West for ourselves. Let's not allow Western scholars to determine what their history is. I think we should in fact write the history of the West, not only for ourselves, but also for them. You know, and this is akin to a suggestion I had made publicly when I published an op-ed piece in the Hindustan Times about 2 years ago, where I argued, many people thought entirely jokingly, but I'm actually quite serious about it, quite frankly, where I argued that when an American election, presidential election takes place, the entire world should be allowed to vote. I simply don't trust the Americans to vote the right person into office. You know, I mean, if the US is going to determine the destiny of the entire world, let the entire world vote in a US presidential election. There's no reason why we should confine it to the US, to an electorate in the US, right? And allow us to be at the mercy of their reason or lack thereof, right? So I think a reverse anthropology, a form of Occidentalism, is very much in order, and that will require an infrastructure. We don't have the kinds of resources that the West has had to study us, but some of that problem is now being alleviated through new kinds of digital technologies, the internet, so forth and so on, open access, so forth and so on, all right? And finally, let me make this point. There was a very interesting debate that took place between Gandhi and two individuals. I'm going to advert to both of these debates for separate reasons in order to make that point. One is a debate that took place between Gandhi and Ambedkar. We don't have the time to get into the intricacies of this particular debate, nor do we have the time to get into the intricacies of the debate that took place between Gandhi and Tagore, right? Two very different kinds of receptivity to Gandhi. Tagore was what you might describe as a friendly critic. And in fact, he becomes more and more friendly over the years. I mean, if you read the exchange that he had with Gandhi in 1919, 1920, 21, 22, during the civil disobedience movement, at that time he took a sharper, still a very respectful, or extraordinarily respectful position towards Gandhi, but he took a critical view of Gandhi's non-cooperation civil disobedience movement for various reasons. He comes around more and more to Gandhi's position, in my view. And if you read one of his classic essays written on the verge of World War II, he more or less makes the argument that the West is a satanic civilization, that this is something he had not understood. He had not understood the brutality that the West was capable of until World War II broke out, right? So this is an essay he writes towards the end of his life, and where he comes around to a position, no, Tagore. Yeah, position that he comes around to embracing, which is close to the position that Gandhi had had for a very long period of time, frankly. The other debate is a debate between Gandhi and Ambedkar. Let me just encapsulate one critical element of it, which is necessary for the point I want to make in concluding my remarks today. That when we think of equality, we invariably think of pushing people upwards. I think one fundamental difference between Gandhi and Ambedkar was that Gandhi took the view that you cannot achieve equality only by pushing people upwards. Some people have to be pushed downwards. Some people have to be pushed downwards. I'm just encapsulating it for you in this way, you know, because you'd have to do a complicated set of readings to get to that point of view. But that's, in essence, the difference between Gandhi and Ambedkar. Having said that, that should give you the cue for what I want to make, for the final observation I want to make. In the diminishment of the United States, right? Not the elimination, not even the humiliation, certainly not the humiliation, but in the diminishment of the United States lies the seeds for a just and equitable world order. The United States has to be diminished. It has to be brought down to a human scale, a scale that would allow other people their freedom, their history, their culture. Thank you.